Then, once the red light comes on, then we're on.
So you want to go up to the website, the most recent reports, you know, S&P Net Advantage, you go to the library. Mergent, that's where you're going to get the financial ratios. Financial, Value Line, they're going to give you reports on the company. Morningstar, they're going to give you reports on the company. If you want really good information, you go to the company's website. You go under Investor Relations, look at the press releases, that'll give you some guidance on where the earnings per share is going next year and going out. And then obviously the quarterly reports. I would also listen to one of the analyst conference calls, because then you get to listen to the senior level managers communicate to the marketplace and listen to the kind of language that they use to the institutional investors, security analysts, and the portfolio managers.
What was that called?
The quarterly analyst conference calls.
Okay.
So maybe podcasts or audio. And they usually last about, you know, no more than 45 minutes to an hour. So you'll get total forward-looking earnings per share estimates. And there's also other, like the Value Line and S&P, they'll give you some projections on where earnings per share is going to go in the future. There's some other people that track it that might give you some guidance. What I would do is take those as guidance, look at the history of earnings per share, and then try to come up with a forecast. What's interesting is if Hillary Clinton would have won, probably the financial services shares, the financial institutions, Goldman, Merrill, Morgan, B of A, Wells, Citi, their stock prices probably would have went down. With the election outcome with Trump, first thing he and Congress want to do is repeal Dodd-Frank, or at least modify Dodd-Frank, which was the regulatory policy that was enacted after the financial crisis. So the financial bank stocks that have been pounded over the last 24 months rose significantly over the last week. So just a totally different viewpoint, because the perception is that with less regulation, earnings per share are going to grow faster over the next 5 years, or at least definitely the next three. You have the research reports. I do have some PowerPoint books for Bank of America. Those PowerPoints are pretty good. I think they're actually PowerPoints. Those are probably pretty good templates to use unless you want to create your own formats and your own tables. Do not deviate from the evaluation methodologies. You know, these pitch books are in pretty good shape. I picked the best ones and threw away the ones that I didn't think were very good. And as you look through them, you'll see that the tables are very precise. This is a standard pitch book. Okay, and I'll go through this a little bit later. You do not want to deviate, okay? Because when you go work somewhere, they're going to come up with certain templates in the way you have to produce information and documentation. You do not have a decision on how these things are to be modified. So you want to be, just like the memos, you got to be very, very attention to detail, you know, on how these things are formatted, okay? And I'll be looking at the format when I'm reviewing your presentations. I also have stock valuation lectures that I gave last semester and the last couple semesters. I also have YouTube videos, not only of my presentation, but also other student presentations. So you can see and I picked the best student presentations and made those available to you as training videos so that you can look through those, model them, see how they do it, and then try to figure out which ones are better than the others, and then try to replicate those. Okay. And you probably want to do some practice runs in the presentations, because you can really tell the students that didn't practice and the ones that did practice. Okay. And I'll go through some techniques on that too. Some student presentations, YouTube videos. Oh, and here's your take-home exam. So there's a lot of resources there, and I'm recording now too. And tonight we'll probably get through the presentation on the deck. And then next time when you come in on Wednesday, we're gonna be doing valuations. So, you know, over the next couple days, you wanna probably do some research, you know, on JP Morgan and Wells Fargo, get your earnings per share forecasts for 2017, 18, 19, 20, 21, and 22. So we can do perpetuity, Gordon growth, multiple approach, see if you can find some PE multiples for not only JP Morgan and Wells Fargo over the last year or two, but also what of the peer group, you know, Goldman, B of A, Wells, Citigroup, what have their multiples been, you know, over the last 14, 15, 16? And what do you think they're going to be for 17? And what you'll see is that the multiples, you know, don't vary that much. They're in a very tight range. So it makes for the valuation relatively easy if you understand how to conduct the analysis. Okay. Let's see, what else? What I want to do next is, how far did we get on the midterm? Did we finish the whole thing?
No.
Did we do the stock valuation?
We saw the last.
The last piece?
We're close.
Did we do the stock valuation? Did we finish the stock? You want to probably move that over here because I'm going to do it over here.
No, we didn't do the stock valuation.
We didn't do the stock valuation?
We did real estate investment banking, not stock.
Okay. So let's finish that. Imagine that you're the team, the securities analysis team. There's new people on your team. There's a new investment committee member, maybe a board of directors member, or senior manager that just started with the firm. And you've been asked to come in and walk us through your approach and how you would value a security. So walk me through the process. What do we start with? What model do we start with first? Last year's EPS. Well, let's not do that yet. So we're not going to get through the presentation on the for the deck if we're not interacting and we don't work on this. So I need you to participate in this to accelerate the process, or you're going to bog down and we're going to run out of time. Then we won't get through the calculations, and then when you come back next week to do JP Morgan, you're not going to have the tools. But you're going to have to interact in this. This is part of the moral process.
So we need to multiply it by the EPS growth.
Yeah, which is?
0.05.
Got it. 1.05, and then that's going to give us, and round it up, please.
13.65.
So basically 14. Now what do we do with that?
Divide it by.
Which is?
0.08.
Okay, that gives us what? Make sure when you're doing the corrections, you're showing me the corrections in blue or red, not in pencil.
1.75.
What is it?
1.75.
Thank you. Okay, done.
Second in.
Thank you. And then Gordon Grove. How do we do it?
We're going to use 13 times the 0.05 of the growth rate.
Okay, which is 14.
Okay. And then we're dividing it by the discounted rate,
mm-hmm. Yep.
Subtracting from that the 0.01, which is the going-in rate.
Okay, great, nice job. And then that's gonna give us 0.07. And what's 14 divided by 0.07? And please break out your calculators.
200.
What is it?
200.
200? Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. So 200. Okay, now we gotta do the multiple approach. So how do we calculate the multiple approach evaluation? What's the equation? Because then I'll show you how to manufacture the multiple.
It's the cash flow times the multiple equals evaluation.
Okay, so 14 times some multiple is going to give us some value. Okay, the multiple. Give me some ways to create a multiple.
PE.
Okay, PE. Price to earnings. Okay. Do we have a current price?
Yep.
What's the current price?
157.
157, and what was last year's earnings per share? What was last year's earnings per share?
13.
Last year, 13. Okay, what's the multiple?
The PE multiple is 15.
Okay. 15 times. And then what about next year's earnings per share of 14? So it's 157 divided by 14. What's that multiple?
11.21.
11 times. Okay. Don't I give you a multiple?
Yeah, you gave us 15.
Okay, so we
already
got it.
Yeah.
All right. And then give me a couple more ways of calculating a multiple.
Wait. So the first one is 12. 157 divided by 13 is 12.
Okay.
And then the one you gave us was 15. Yeah,
okay.
Sorry.
Okay, so we'll do that in a minute. 15 times. Okay, give me some other ways of calculating a multiple.
Gordon growth.
Okay. So walk me through it.
It's 1 over
0.08
minus.
Is it 0.08? Okay, yeah, go for it.
0.08 minus 0.01, which is 0.07.
Okay. And then what multiple does that give us?
That's
14.
14?
Mm-hmm.
10 times. And then what's another way to calculate the multiple?
Perpetuity.
Okay. That's 1 divided by 0.08. And then what does that give us? What is it?
12.5.
So 13?
Sure.
Okay. So what do we have? 11, 12, 13, 14, and 15 times. Okay. Do you think multiples are going to go up or down? They're currently around what? 11 and 12. Right? This was probably high. That's pretty high, right?
Yeah.
Right? So these are probably on the high side. Right? These are market high, Gordon growth high. This is using next year's against the current price here, and this is last year's against the current price. So of those multiples, which one do you want to use? Do you think they're going to be as high as 15?
No.
Do you think they're going to be as low as 11?
Probably not.
So it's got to be either 12, 13, 14. What do you want to use?
13.
What you'll probably do is you'll look at the competitors, right? You'll look at the other banks, and you'll look at 2014, 15, 16, or 15, 16, 17. And what you'll see is all of their multiples also are within this range. Okay, so that's going to be confirmation. So we'll use 13. So what's 13 times 14? What's 13 times 14?
182.
182?
182, that's right.
Okay. So we got the multiple, we got Gordon growth, we got perpetuity. So we got three of the the model's done already. Okay, now we're gonna do discounted cash flow. So can you walk me through the DCF?
So we have to do the present value?
Yeah, we're gonna do the present value of the cash flows. We're gonna use the DCF model to calculate the last one. Walk me through DCF.
So are we starting with 14 then?
Do we use last year's, this year's, or next year's earnings per share?
Next year's.
Which is going to be
14.
How many years are we going out?
Five.
Okay.
Plus four.
Go ahead.
We're going out 6.
Yeah.
Take us.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then we'll.
Technically 6, yeah.
Okay.
So 14 times 1.05.
Got it. And what does that give us?
It's 14.7.
Okay, and then what do we do?
Multiply it by 1.04.
1.04, and what is 14.7 times 1.04? And you should be doing this on your calculator, so you're practicing this.
15,
so it becomes an 8. What is it?
15.3.
Yep.
15.3.
Which we multiply by 1.03.
1.03. Okay.
Yeah, 15.7.
15.7. Got it.
That's correct.
And then we multiply that by 1.02.
Got it. And what's 15.07 times 1.02? 16.
Yeah.
16.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Excellent. Thank you. And then what do we do?
Multiply it by 1.01.
Okay. And what does that give us?
16.
Okay. And then what do we do? What are we calculating here?
Terminal value.
And how do we calculate that? How do we calculate that?
I minus G.
What is it?
Yeah,
give me the numbers.
So, 1.01.
What's the number? I know it's I minus G.
Is
what?
0.01.
Great. So 0.09.
Mm-hmm.
So it's 16 times 0.09.
Divided by?
Yeah, 16. Sorry, divided by 0.09.
178.
178. Okay, and then what do we do with that?
Add that to
the last.
To what?
Add that to the 5th year.
To what?
The 5th year cash flow.
Yeah. Which is 16? Okay, and that's going to give us what? So it's 178 plus 16.
194.
What is it?
194.
Okay, now what do we do?
Divide them all by their discount factors.
Excellent, nice job. Okay, give me the discount factors.
1.08 to the first.
Okay, excellent.
And then 1.08 to the second.
Excellent.
1.8 to the third.
Okay, thank you.
And then to the fourth.
Can you give me the discount factors, please?
1.8, 1.17, 1.26.
Is everybody checking these?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
1.36.
Okay.
And then 1.47.
1. What?
47.
And what's 194 divided by 1.47?
132.
Okay, and what is 15 divided by 1.36?
11.
And then what is 15.3 divided by 1.26? What is it?
Is this supposed to be 15.7 divided by 1.36?
Yep.
Oh.
Did you get a different number than 11?
No.
11.5?
Yeah, 11.5. Sorry.
That's okay. And then 15.3 divided by 1.26?
12.
And then what's 14.7 divided by 1.17?
12.5.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then what's 14 divided by 1.08?
13.
What is it?
13.
13. And 13 plus 12.5 plus 12 plus 11.5 plus 132.
$181.
Okay. So we got, what's the perpetuity? No. What's the number? What's the intrinsic value?
175.
175. And then what's Gordon growth?
200.
200.
Okay. 200. And what's the multiple?
13.
182.
Oh.
182. Then what is DCF? 181. Okay, and then did you have any scenarios? Did you have any weighting schemes that we could apply to get the intrinsic value?
Well, our current stock price is 157.
I know that, so that's going to be what we compare it against, right? So what's the weight? What's the scenario? How are we going to weight these? You have to have three scenarios, 5-5, 10-10, 25-25, 25-25. No, you have to have three scenarios and then you pick one. So we're weighting the different types of intrinsic values by the different methodologies. So can you give me some weighting schemes? Which one are you going to weight the most?
DCF.
Exactly. By how much?
Both.
How much?
60.
Okay, and then how much for multiple?
40? No, that's
15.
15.
15 sounds good. 15.15.
0.15.
Okay.
And then Gordon Growth, same.
0.15.
Say it. Go ahead. Is it? 60, 70, 80, 90,
100?
100. 100?
Yeah.
Okay. And why did you give Gordon Growth the same weight as multiple? And multiple is the most popular.
Because they're both.
No. Why did you give Gordon Growth the same weight as the multiple, and the multiple is more popular as a methodology? It's the most popular method. DCF is more accurate, multiple is more popular than Gordon Growth. So why would you give the same weighting?
Maybe you
so
should
we
change
need to
it.
Do a different scenario?
Okay, you probably want to do a different scenario.
20 to multiple?
What is it?
20 to multiple or 25? You want to do 25?
25?
No, we can do
25. What is this? Do you think maybe you gave too much here?
So would you do like 45?
You might have given too much here.
45, so that's
50,
75, 80,
30,
40, 50. Yeah, it's 100.
Something like that?
Sounds good.
I mean, you're going to have to play with it. You've got to come up with three scenarios, but you're going to have to come up with one that makes sense. You know, 5-5, for these two, 10-10 is good, 15-15, but you have to do three. I would do three. I pick this one. Okay. So what do you get? So what's 175 times 0.1? Is it 17.5? Is that right?
I think so. 175.
This one's what, 20?
Times 20.
What's 182 times
0.3? 90.5.
What is it?
90.5. I'm doing the DCF.
Oh.
182 times
0.3.
I got 55.
55.
Yeah.
Okay. And then what is 181 times 0.5, so give me half that.
90.5.
What is it?
91.
Okay, and then what's 17.5 plus 20 plus 55 plus 91?
37, 92, 183.5. 183.5?
183.
Yeah.
Is it greater than the current stock price?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. What's your recommendations?
Accept.
Yeah. No, that's in capital budgeting.
Oh, then do not, yeah. Reject.
Nope. That's in capital budgeting.
Do you buy stock?
We're doing securities analysis now. We're not doing capital budgeting. We're using capital budgeting techniques. We're using discounted cash flow to get the value of the share. Okay, we're not doing... So there's different... What are the trades? What are your trade recommendations? This is really what we're looking at. So what are your trades?
Buy stock.
Okay, buy. Give me some more.
Buy call.
Before we buy the calls, let's do something else.
Buy a margin.
Okay. Buy a margin. Okay, buy calls. What else?
Write the puts.
Write puts.
Write puts. Okay, and how many trades?
Yes.
Does that give us?
Nine.
That's
no.
Four.
12.
So one stock.
Oh, so
one stock.
Three, four.
Four trades. Okay. And if the stock is makes up a significant portion of an exchange traded fund, what would be your additional trades? Let's say this was IBM or something, and it was a tech stock.
Buy forwards.
No, but the exchange traded funds.
Oh.
Okay, don't go there. So if the stock makes up a significant portion of the ETF, what would be the trades? The stock makes up a significant portion of the exchange traded funds, which means the stock price and the returns on the stock and the ETF are correlated.
Are you trying to hedge?
No, we're actually, the stock price and the returns on the stock are highly correlated to the exchange traded fund price and its return. So what trades would you make if there was correlation between the ETF and the stock?
You'd buy stock.
Buy the stock. What else? You buy the ETF.
Yeah.
And what else?
Buy calls on futures.
No, don't go there yet. We're still doing the ETF. Are stocks and ETFs traded on the exchange? Yes. Okay, so if there's correlation between the price and the returns between the stock and the ETF, what would be your trades? It would be what? The same thing. Okay, so how many trades would you have?
Four more.
Total of
eight.
And if the stock makes up a significant portion of the stock index, then what trades would you use? And there's correlation between the two. Then what would be the trades on the index?
The same ones. The ETF, huh?
This is on the index. These are your memos. This is your memo exercise. It all ties right back. So what are your trades? The stock's price and return are highly correlated to the stock index. What are the trades?
Buy forwards.
Buy forwards.
Buy futures.
Futures.
Buy calls on futures.
Buy calls.
Write the puts on futures.
And futures. And you would write
puts on futures.
Futures for how many trades?
A total of five.
For how many trades?
One. Four.
Four. A total of
12.
Okay, that's it. Okay. All right. So now let's do the last one. The investment decision making matrix. Financial feasibility matrix. Your investment underwriting matrix. It's all basically the same thing. So how do I set up the table?
Four columns.
Okay.
Well, I guess five if you want to include the names of what we're doing.
Financial investment decision making. Also can be the financial investment underwriting. Financial decision making matrix, financial underwriting matrix, investment decision making matrix, it's all the same thing. Okay, so what's in the first column?
present value net.
Present value.
Is greater than equal to or less than
the
price.
Oh, PV equal to.
Is greater than what?
The price.
The price.
The price.
Okay, or the cost. Okay. What's the next one?
PV equal to.
Okay, what's the next one?
Less than.
PV less than.
Okay.
And you can draw a line.
Okay, what's the next one?
Net present value.
MPV.
Positive.
Positive.
MPV zero equal to zero.
Zero.
MPV negative.
And then we'll go through this in a minute. Okay, and then the next one?
IRR is greater than the WACC.
Okay.
And then equal to the WACC.
Okay.
And then less than.
Okay, excellent. And then the last one?
E over E is less
break
than.
Break even?
Yeah. Less than 5 years.
Okay, I'll use three.
Number three, yeah.
Okay, and then the next one?
Break even equal to.
Equal to three.
Break even less than.
Okay. And actually, this one's less than. Sorry.
The top one's less than?
Yeah, break even is less than. Okay, that's right. And then break even is greater than 3 years. Okay. So this is going to be our first iteration. Number one. Give me the investment decision to keep.
Accept.
Okay, accept. Okay.
Accept. Reject.
Reject.
Accept.
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 Reject.
Reject. Okay, keep going.
Accept.
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 Reject.
And the next one?
Accept.
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 Reject.
Reject. Okay. Excellent. Whew. That was tough. Okay. So, net present value is negative. IRR is less than WACC. Break even is greater than 3 years. What do we do now? We really want the project. The client really wants the project. What do we do now?
Ask for a price reduction in the amount of the negative NPV.
Nice job. Okay. So what you would do to get to accept the project, right? And we're really going to, if we get the negative NPV, if we get a price reduction or cost reduction, in the amount of the negative NPV, what is our net present value become?
Zero.
Zero. And we would end up
accepting.
Accepting. And what does the present value do compared to the price?
It just becomes equal.
Equal.
Becomes equal.
Accepted. What about the IRR?
It becomes equal to WACC.
Equal to WACC and break even?
Equal to 3 years.
It would be equal to 3 years. Awesome. Okay, sorry, bad news. Can't get the price reduction. So, do we have another option?
Yes.
Yep. Iteration number three. What do we do?
Review original assumptions.
Yeah, we're going to audit. Review assumptions. Excellent. And what are those assumptions?
Overestimated Gordon growth.
Well, take me through the individual assumptions, the individual variables. TV, GT, IT. Okay, excellent.
Percentage rate?
Yeah, the growth rate and the cash flows.
Mm-hmm.
What about the level of the cash flows?
It could be overestimated.
When you start off too low on one, then everything's too low, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the cash flows?
Beta.
Oh, nice job. So let's walk us through the cost of the equity. So you got beta, What else is in the calculation for CapEx?
Risk premium rate.
Mm-hmm. Risk premiums.
That's going to be the cost of the debt.
And the expected return on market.
Yeah, we got the expected return on the market. Okay, excellent. We got risk premiums. We got risk free rate. We got underestimated. So you go through them and you know where you made your mistakes, right? Any other variables here?
Capital.
We just did that. If we're calculating the weighted average cost of capital, you already know about the cost of the debt and equity. Where else could we have made a mistake? When we calculated the weighted average cost of capital, we already audited the CAPM assumptions and the risk premium assumptions. In the weighted average cost of capital, where could we have made our mistake? In the what? What's the weighted average cost of capital? Weighted average.
The calculation.
Weights. Okay, what weights? What weights do we calculate? The weight, the cost of the debt and the equity, you get the weighted average cost of capital, which is our discount rate.
Tax shield.
What? Okay, maybe the tax shield. That would have been under the cost of the debt, so obviously taxes. Weighted average. Well, we already have the cost of capital calculation, so what are we missing that we're not talking about in regards to the weighted average cost of capital? Weighted average. Oh, the weights.
Oh, I said that, sorry.
Oh, did you? Okay, what weights?
Yeah, I think. Yeah.
What weights?
The weighted equity and weighted debt.
Weighted the equity, weighted the debt. Okay. Which one is more expensive? Cost of equity or the cost of debt?
Cost of equity.
Equity is more, say it.
Because of the tax shield, the equity is more expensive.
That's right. And then can you deduct the dividends paid out to shareholders?
Yes. Oh, no.
No. Can you deduct the interest on the interest paid to bondholders?
No.
No.
The interest on the bonds, can you deduct them? Can you deduct the interest?
Yes.
Yes, you can. Okay. Yes, you can. That's where the tax shield comes from. Okay. So if the equity is more expensive than the debt, where did you make your mistake? In regards to the weights, where did you make your mistake? Did you over or underestimate the weight of the equity? Did you over? If the cost of the equity is more expensive,
you overestimated
the weight of the equity. That's where you could have made your mistake. Okay. Any other variables that we could have audited? Growth rates, terminal values, going in discount rates, CAPM, risk free rates, the weights. I think we might have got all. Okay, bad news. We reviewed all the assumptions, they were correct, we still get a negative NPV. What do we do?
I'm going to write a real call off.
I'm not going to write it.
Calculate it.
Calculate
Real call option.
The value of the real call option. Okay. And if you calculate the real call option, what does the value need to be?
Zero.
No, it doesn't need to be.
Amount of the net profit.
That's right. It needs to be in the amount equal to or greater than the amount of the negative NPV. And if your real call option is equal to or greater than your negative NPV, what's your net present value?
Zero.
Equal to zero. Do you accept or reject it?
Accept.
If the real call option value is greater than the negative NPV amount, what's your net present value? If the real call option value is greater than your negative net present value, then your net present value is what?
Positive.
Are you going to accept or reject it?
Accept.
You're going to accept it. If the real call option value comes in under and is less than the negative net present value, then what's your net present value?
Negative.
equals negative, are you going to accept or reject it?
You're going to reject.
Okay. Can you give me three factors that drive real call option values? When you're modeling out and calculating the real call option value, what are the three factors that determine real call option values?
Buy on margin?
Huh?
Buy on margin?
No, those are just trades.
The valuation volatility?
You got it. Nice job. The more volatile the values are, the higher the probability that the values will go in the money and overcompensate for the negative NPV. Give me a couple more.
Time value.
Time value. Nice job. What's more valuable? A 5-year call option, real call option, or a 10-year real call option?
10.
Because you have more time, and if it's volatile, you have a higher probability that the volatility will cause the valuations to go in the money and overcompensate for the negative NPV. Give me one more. One more factor that will drive real call option values.
Management decisions.
Management decisions. If the management has 5 years to make the decision to pull the trigger on the deal, and the valuations are highly volatile, there's increased probability that the management can make a decision to basically increase the probability that they'll be in the money. If they don't have to buy the piece of land for 5 years, they could wait for the recession to hit, and then go in and buy the piece of land at its discount at the very bottom of the cycle, and then ride the valuation up. So that management decision actually adds to the real call option value. Okay? And I think they talk about real call options in the book, but it's way, way in the back of the chapter. Okay? Any questions on that? Okay. So let's jump right into the, does everybody have a pitch book? I'm going to borrow a pitch book because I'm going to need the pitch books back. Do you have your own pitch book?
We don't have any.
I don't have it with me. It's in my
room. Okay, will you give somebody an extra? Do you have any pitch books?
Cheyenne has one, but can we borrow one for today?
Yeah. Then I'm going to need all these back because I need them for now.
Yeah.
And if you have any extras, I'm going to take them back.
Do you want us to keep recording this?
Yeah, because this is really important. Or somebody can share it. So let's go through the pitch books. This is your end product, okay? This is what you're shooting for. Now, personally, I don't like this cover page because it's opaque. I like the clear, okay? And I've already called the print shop, the ordering, the materials. So once you're done, you can go over there with your file and you can print it out in color and they'll bind it for you right there. And I think it's like $12 or something like that. So it's not expensive compared to if you have to go to Kinko's or something like that. And the only reason why these presentations, and I try to throw out the ones that I don't like that are not perfect, is because I can't give them to you. Okay. So I'm trying to screen out all the ones that I think have errors in it. This one's pretty good. So I like the clear cover, black back, and exactly these types of bindings. Exactly these types of things. Because when you're going to go into the business environment, senior level managers are going to have standards by reporting standards. This is exactly what the pitch book is going to look like when you make the presentation to your team. This is exactly what they're going to look like when you make the presentation to the investment committee. This is exactly the way they're going to look when you make the presentation to the board. This is exactly the way they're going to look when you make the presentation to the client. And you can't deviate, okay? You can't just go, it doesn't look good, or I didn't have enough time to put into it, so it doesn't look very good. That's not gonna cut it, okay? It's gotta look exactly like this. And you're gonna have somebody like me that's probably gonna review everything and to make sure it's perfect, because our reputation's on the line when we make the presentation, Okay, so the product itself is extremely important, that it's done correctly. So as you go through, and this is what you'll probably do, is you'll probably do a PowerPoint presentation, which you're going to do, and then you're going to hand out the pitch books to the individuals within the room, and you're going to walk them through it. Okay, and I'm going to walk you through it right now. So right here, come
on. We only need one pitch book, right?
You're going to have a, this is the way we're going to do it, okay? So when you come back and make your presentation next week, okay, what you're going to do is you're going to print it out, black and white, one slide per page, stapled, okay? You're going to give it to me so that I can correct it as you're making the formal presentation, okay?
This is next Monday?
It's the 21st.
Okay.
Yep, so that's going to be your first run, then you got Thanksgiving, then you come back and you do your second, you do the second one, you do Wells Fargo. We're doing JP Morgan. So, you're going to come in, I'm going through the environment first, and then I'll talk about what we're going to do in class, because they're slightly different, okay? So you're going to be up, you're going to be doing your presentation, you're going to have the PowerPoint up there, and you're going to be walking them through the presentation, usually with the pitch book. Because a lot of these guys will be older, if they're board members and senior level executives, they won't be looking up at the PowerPoint, they'll be looking down at the pitch book. And you gotta have it in color, and it's gotta be all clean and really easy to read and walk them through it. Okay? And it, usually the presentation is 8 minutes, no more than 10. And then usually in the environment, you'll probably have 20 to 30 minutes, maybe 40 minutes of Q&A, depending on the results of the analysis and if they have any questions. And they will, and I will, ask you questions. How'd you come up with the risk-free rate? Where'd you get the beta? Where'd you get the expected return on the market? How'd you calculate the weights? How'd you get the EPS? How'd you come up with the growth rate scenarios for next year and the year after?
Do you normally have more questions if it's accepted
and rejected? If the board doesn't have a problem or the investment committee, all the assumptions are reasonable, they're not going to have any and they'll just go, great job, we'll go forward with the recommendation. But if there's errors or if there's typos or the results are counterintuitive, they're going to grill you. And they may, you know, like me, totally humiliate you in front of the board and basically throw all your research out the window. Because one thing was off, then they grilled you and totally discredited you in front of everybody. Because if there's one thing that's off, then they have assumption that everything else is screwed up too. So you got to be really super careful. When you're doing the presentation, make sure these are reviewed by people. Everybody looks over them. Everybody checks them for reasonability. That's the production and marketing person's job, the finance person, and the leader all should be auditing this stuff. And then I won't let this stuff go out until I sign off on it. Okay? So when you give it to me, I'll give you some initial feedback. Next week, you'll go back, you'll correct it, you'll correct Wells Fargo, you'll bring Wells Fargo and JP Morgan back the following week. I'll edit those as fast as I can, give them back to you. You'll do the corrections, come back, give it to me again. I'll edit it again for any last minute stuff, and we'll go back and forth until I try to get them as clean as usable, right? Because again, if you think this is an academic experiment, then basically you'll submit anything just to get the grade or hope you'll get a grade. If you're going to use this for interviewing purposes as part of your portfolio for an internship or a job, then this becomes extremely useful to be able to distance yourself from other candidates. Okay, so. Some people don't have a problem because they already have job offers, but there's a lot of other people that don't have the luxury of being pre-selected in the process. So here you got the cover page, you got the logo, you know it's Goldman Sachs valuation report, there's a buy recommendation. The intrinsic value is $224. The price is right next to it. So quickly I can say buy and then look at the pricing, okay, without getting distracted from the words. St. Mary's College, we know when it was done, who the team was, and it was for me. Okay. We have a quick overview, background, financial analysis, stock valuation, and recommendation. We have a little background on the company. Make sure that everything's formatted correctly in here. Don't go on too long, just hit on some high points. Then you have the products and services. Usually I ask the students to put stars. Maybe 1, 2, 3 stars, 1 or 2 stars next to the products and services that are the best selling products and services or make up the majority of the revenue that's generated.
So right off the bat, I know what the comparative advantage is and where, what product innovation and what product dominance these companies have within their space. You have the leadership, as you can see, a bunch of white guys, you know, from the East Coast, all with Ivy League schools. Okay. These pictures right here, don't take them for granted. They're really hard to find. And usually the students will have like Lloyd Blankfield's head the size of a little freaking baseball, and then they'll have the other ones. It's all distorted, the squares. If you look at the pictures in those pitch books, they're perfect. Okay, there's no distorted head of Lloyd Blankfield. They look really, really professional. We want their names. We want their titles. We want the number of years they've been with the company. We want the Ivy League education that they have, and we want where they worked before. Most of Goldman Sachs, JP Morgan, B of A, those companies recruit from the outside, and they all have Ivy League educations. Wells Fargo, US Bank, those guys have hired locally, and they promote internally. Totally different culture. Okay, so that tells you a lot right there, what the culture and leadership style is of the top people. You're not putting in board of directors. You put people who actually run divisions. Okay, no boards of directors. I've seen it before. Well, somebody will put Lloyd there, and then they got the board of directors. Board of directors don't do anything but approve what the CEO says. Okay, so you need people who are actually doing stuff, and you have to have six. Okay, six people. And then you should be able to talk about the leadership style and the culture of the company on this, on the, from this page. Go ahead.
Well, I've never said most of them have the logos in the corner somewhere.
Yeah,
that's what you want?
Okay. Definitely.
Okay.
And you got to remember that you're not representing the company. You're investing the investment management company. You are stock analysts or portfolio analysts or private equity or public equity analysts that are making investment recommendations. You don't work for these companies. Okay? I've noticed a lot of students, I guess, get emotionally attached to these companies. You have the organizational structure of the company, so you know the divisional lines, how the company is organized by division, and where their comparative advantages are, and how they align to profit maximize with the marketplace. So the org structure is huge. And then the really good students down here will put the revenue and the revenue contribution by lines of business. And you can see Goldman Sachs gets 64% of its revenue from investment banking, where other banks will get their revenues from different places. Like Wells Fargo, most of their revenue comes from mortgage underwriting, residential. You know, so different banks have different comparative advantages. And then you have the Goldman Sachs revenue percentages, and right off the bat, you can see that institutional client services is the biggest contributor to the revenue of the company. Bank rankings, you have the top five banks. And this is by total assets. What's important about this chart is if you sum up the total assets for the top banks and divide them back and get the weights, those weights are what you're going to use to calculate the weighted average financial ratios. So let's say you have the weights for the top five banks and you have return on equity for each of the banks. You can calculate the weighted average of the return on equity for the top five banks. That's going to be your peer group. So you're going to have to build an Excel spreadsheet. It basically takes the assets, sums them up, divides them back, gets the weights, and then you plug in ROE for the top five banks. It's going to calculate the weighted average. That becomes the peer group ratio in your ratio analysis, which I'll show you in a minute. And I'll walk you through those calculations. Okay. In the financial reports, the value line, the, you know, S&P, Morningstar, they're not going to give you peer group. You got to calculate peer group. They'll give you industry, but we don't care about industry really. We just have it in there. What we wanted, what these companies need to do is beat their peer group in their financial ratios. You need to conduct a SWOT analysis. What a lot of students do is they will just cut and paste this from the industry reports, or the reports out of Morningstar or something like that, and just plop it in there. Now, I've read a lot of these, so I already know what all these are. You know, I know a lot of this stuff. What I would do is probably build a SWOT analysis use the analysis that's presented to you, put it in here and re-rank them based on priority. Your biggest strengths, biggest weaknesses, biggest opportunities, rank order. And then as you're doing the research about these companies, there may be some strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats that were not brought up in the SWOT analysis in the report, but you came across in your research, and you would put those in there to make them more comprehensive and updated. The financial condition of the company, these are the financial ratio analysis. Basically, what you have is you'll have financial ratios by category, profitability, leverage. You'll have, in this case, Goldman Sachs, which is the target company. You'll have JP Morgan right next to it, which is the direct competitor. You will have calculated your weighted average ratios to get the peer group ratios, and then the industry ratios are given to you. So the key is to compare the financial ratio of the target company with the competitor and mainly the peer group. Now, the companies that you're looking at, the top five companies, JP and Wells Fargo, these are of the top five companies. So they're going to blow away the industry, okay, in most cases. If they're falling below the industry, then there's something wrong. In most cases, they're going to meet or beat the peer group or meet or beat the direct competitor. And if their financial ratios are significantly better than the direct competitor in the peer group, you're going to give it an excellent. You're going to give it an excellent rating. If it's better than the direct competitor and the peers, pretty close but slightly above, you're going to give it a good. If it's above the industry, you're probably going to give it above average. If it's equal to the industry, you're going to give it an average. And if it's below the industry, you're going to give it a low. These are what you're going to use. You cannot deviate from these codes. Okay? You can't give it like totally freaking awesome and sucks. You know, you don't do that. Okay? You use these codes. And then what you do is you code, after you conduct a financial ratio analysis, you code these, and then you step back and look, and you see what the overall code is. And if most of it is above average or good, you give an overall score of good or above average. Okay? This sets the underlying fundamental analysis. Before you can go conduct your securities analysis, you've got to do financial ratio analysis to get an overall picture of the financial condition and position of the firm. Okay? On the next page, you're going to have equity ratios, forward PEs, ROE, ROA, you're going to have debt coverage, profit margins, you're going to have key financial ratios that then we can assess the overall financial condition and position of the firm compared to the direct competitor, the peer group, in the industry. So this sets the fundamental analysis to move forward. You're going to have technical analysis, where basically you're going to look at the trend, you're going to set the supports, resistance, identify any breakouts, and any upward or downward trending in the stock price. Because again, the stock price is forward looking, and the market is doing all these valuation methods. If they think that earnings per share growth rates are going to start to decelerate, then it's going to be reflected in the trend in the stock price. And then what you need to do is to put the trend line together, if there is one, and then theoretically extend it out by 1 year to try to interpolate what the target price would be in 1 year from now, and that becomes the target price. And it shouldn't say intrinsic stock value, it should say target stock price, because you're using technical analysis, not intrinsic valuation methods for this. So the technical analysis is another method that theoretically should confirm your intrinsic valuation methods. Next is the perpetuity model. Okay. right off the bat, right at the top, you're going to get the intrinsic value that you came up with from the method compared to the stock price. And for some of you, there should be a premium next to it in dollar or percentage terms. And usually what you want is you want the intrinsic values to be within and or under 20%. Because either your assumptions are wrong if the stock price value that you're coming up with is way far from the current stock price. Go ahead. What's your question?
So should our number, like everyone's numbers, be the same because it's the same?
Should be close.
Okay.
If the stock price is 200 and you're getting 300, your growth rates are too high or your discount rate's too low. Okay. There's something wrong, right? So they should be relatively tight. Okay. I've only seen students, and I obviously threw them away, the ones that weren't very good and the ones that were way off. Okay. Some of them were just horrible, so I just throw them away. Okay. These are some of the best ones that I kept. Okay. So over here you see the CAPM calculation. They came up with the risk-free rate, the beta. This is where a lot of students make their mistakes, is they use the calculated beta from Yahoo Finance. Okay? They don't even go to Mergent, they don't go to S&P, they don't go to IBIS, they don't go to Value Line, they're just too lazy. Because again, they have to go log in, go to the library, go to the online databases, go to Mergent, go in and search for the data. It's like five steps. But that data is really accurate. If you go to Yahoo Finance, be careful, because those guys make mistakes. Okay. So they came up with the beta, forward-looking beta. They used the expected market return of between 8 and 10%. They came up with the cost of the equity. Okay. You have two sensitivities. You have the cost of the equity, and you have the market expected return. Expected return of the market. The only other one that you have next is the weighted average cost of capital. So you want to kind of have all three, and then your sensitivities are around those three data points. Okay. Also underneath here, you have the earnings per share. You have last year's, this year's, and next year's, and the growth rates underneath them, because I want to see the trend. And then, as you can see down here, the 10% was the CAPM calculation, the 8% was the return on the market, and the 9% in the middle was the weighted average cost of capital. All of these valuations all tie together. And I'm going to be asking you questions. Where'd you get the EPS? Where'd you get the, how'd you come up with the beta? How'd you come up with the risk-free rate? How did you determine the expected return on the market? Do you think in these meetings they're going to be totally grilling you on all your assumptions?
Yeah.
Yeah, totally. Totally. And you got to be prepared. Gordon growth, again, just a replication of the perpetuity, but you're adding in the growth rates along the top, and then the discount rates along the bottom. Always go from a high, medium, low, okay, in the valuations. Now, we all know that these companies are over $1 trillion, so they're huge companies. There's no way in hell they're ever going to be able to grow earnings per share greater than 1%. Okay, but I just put in 1, 2, 3 to show the sensitivities, because in other stock valuations that you may be doing in the future, you got to know that you're going to be using discount rate sensitivities and growth rate sensitivities when you apply Gordon growth. Okay? So in this case, what they did was they picked 1% and they used CAPM as the discount rate to get the valuation. For the multiple approach, they used 11, 10, 9. As you can see, we had 3 years of multiples. You can have 2015, 16, and 17. 17 is your forward projected multiple. You already have pretty much 16, which is pretty close. And then you have full year numbers for 2015. If you use the top five banks for basically 15, 16, 17, you're going to get a range of multiples. They're all going to be really tight together, right? And then if you look at last year's multiple, this year's multiple, and next year's multiple for the company, they're all going to come within a range. And then you just set it, in this case, was 11, 10, and 9. Okay, so it's the analysis is in coming up with the numbers. Okay, and then on the DCF model, I wanted to see them calculate the weighted average cost of capital. I will check the weights. I will ask you how you got your cost of debt. And the best way to get the cost of debt is to go see what the bonds are yielding right now on long-term maturities for these banks. Go find a 7 or a 10 year corporate bond and look at the yield. Or look in their annual report or some of their disclosures in the footnotes and look at when they issued the bonds, what was the yield to maturity on the bonds when they were issued? And that'll give you an approximation. And let's say it was 5% over the last 2 years. Well, we know that the 10-year treasury yield is up 50 basis points since last year. So if they were issuing the bonds at 5%, I would tack on another 50 basis points, or maybe 100, and use 6%. Does that make sense? Yeah, because when they were issued, interest rates were low. Interest rates are going through the roof now. The 10-year treasury is going to be up 100 basis points by next year. So find out what they issued at last year and add 100 basis points on top of it. And if you think the bank is going to be more risky and it has a lot of leverage and a lot of credit default, add a little bit more. So do you understand how to assess the credit risk? And then we already know the CAPM equation. So that your CAPM calculation needs to be the same cost of equity on this slide. Okay. And then you have earnings per share will be at the top. Top row, very first row should be earnings per share. You can show last year's, but you're going to need to show 17, 18, 19, 20, and 21. Okay, you're going to have to grow out 22 and calculate the terminal value, and I like to see the terminal value. And then give us the present value of the cash flows. So that last cash flow in the last year has got to be the biggest one, right? Because it's the terminal value plus the cash flow in the last year discounted. And then you have the valuation right there. So the valuation is in three places on DCF. It's up here, down here, and right there. Okay. Right from high value to low value at different discount rates. Okay. And I like to see the growth rates too under the EPS so I can see how you're projecting out the earnings per share growth rates over the 5-year holding period. Then the second to last slide. Do you have the weighted stock valuations under your three scenarios? And you can see 5-5, 10-10, 25-25-25 in some cases. Calculate the intrinsic value. And usually underneath this intrinsic value, your scenario should be in the middle. Okay? And then underneath it, there should be a buy recommendation. So right there again, it ties right to the very first slide and reminds the investment committee you're making a buy recommendation. And then on the last slide, the recommendation, you're going to have the intrinsic stock value greater than the current stock price. It could be a sell for all we know. A big buy recommendation here, there should be a premium over here. So I know that you're within the 20%. And then you're going to have the number of trades. In that case, we had 12 trades. And then you're going to list all of the trades. Buy on margin, buy calls, right puts on the stock, buy on margin, buy calls, right puts on the financial services ETFs, and you're going to buy forwards, buy futures, buy calls on futures, right puts on futures, on financial services stock indexes. Okay, so now you have 12 trades. And then the last maybe Q&A, you might want to put an appendix in there that lists the references in where you got your data. So that when I ask you, where did you get the data? I don't know. And I've gotten that a lot. I don't know where I got the data. How did you get that number? I don't know. Because you copied it. I've actually had one class, one group that copied the presentation from another presentation and submitted it with the exact same data, but changed the branding on it. So when they did the J.P. Morgan presentation, they came back and did the Wells Fargo presentation. The Wells Fargo data was the exact same as the J.P. Morgan data. And when I called them on it, they kind of yelled at me, basically told me to be quiet, and told the others in the class that totally busted them, started basically shutting them down too. I really didn't, I didn't see it until the end, you know, but it was like totally humiliating on everybody's. So these things are really, really important, okay? So what we'll do next on Wednesday is we'll run through the financial ratio analysis calculations and we'll run through the valuations. You need to go online for base earnings per share for 2015, 16, and 17, and then start making forecasts out to 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, and 22, and start practicing the valuations. Come up with some discount rates. And start running it so that when you get here and you start running the valuations, we can be working with each other. And again, you as the teams may have slightly different assumptions. And I start to question when everybody's, you know, research report has exactly the same numbers that I came up with in class. So there was no due diligence. It was just replicating the information. And you may have different views on beta and risk rates and stuff. So you can shut that off. Yeah, you can take pictures of this stuff. These are probably good.